Oh, I feel good today. Y'all feel good today? Some of y'all need to wake up. Some of y'all like, we had coffee and pancakes. I wore a new shirt for you. And I got a cool outfit for Easter. I went shopping with my wife yesterday. Went down to El Centro, the shopping spot of the country. What's in El Centro? Dillard's. I like Dillard's. They have a Caribbean brand. And your pastor is an island man, so do the math. All right, we had a great time. Great time. One thing I learned yesterday, you ever notice when you're with your wife and you're having those really cool times and you get that epiphany, we should do this more often. You know? Anybody have those? Jared, you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. You know what's bothering me is you just started growing that beard like a month ago, and you're almost caught up with me. And this is like 2 years. Oh, my goodness. Young people. You got to love them because you can't shoot them. Yeah. Yeah, we just had a blast. And everything we did was just turned out to be cool. Don't you like those days when everything... Even the restaurant we went to was just cool. I mean, everything we did was cool. We are cool, but you know, but it was just cool. Had a great time. Laughed a lot. Y'all laugh a lot. It makes you healthy. They say the average person in America laughs 3 times a day. Who are those poor people? You need to laugh. Well, why is it too serious? Well, yeah. The joy of the Lord. There's people dying, going to hell. I have to be serious. Well, you're not their savior. You know? People would probably be more attracted to Jesus than us if we would laugh more. People are looking for happy folks. I'm sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm happy. Tell your face. Your face needs to know it. I am happy. I'm smiling. Well, we got a different definition of smiling and happy. Hallelujah. Isn't it great to be carefree, free of cares? Not to worry. Don't worry. Be happy. You're supposed to be, how many of y'all worry? You shouldn't worry. Oh, do you watch the news? If you can't handle the news, don't watch it. I don't watch it. Well, how are you going to do things if you don't know what's going on? The Lord tells me what to get involved in, what not. You know, the Bible says in Psalms 130, it says, I do not behave myself in matters too great for me. You know, sometimes we think that we're the Savior or we're the answer to everything you hear. You know? Just pray. And if you that have a burden for the world, more power to you. I'm working on Ramona right now. Amen? Man, I've been praying for Syria. Oh, I'm praying for Afghanistan. Man, pray for Ramona. And if you haven't reached your neighbors, what are you doing praying for across the world? Sometimes you won't even ever see the fruit of that. I'm not saying you shouldn't. I pray for Jerusalem because the Bible commands you to. But it didn't command you to pray for every country on the planet. The ones you have connection to, the ones the Lord puts that on your heart. Hallelujah. All right, let's talk about, got to tell somebody. I want to tell somebody. You know, when you're excited about something, you want to tell somebody. You know, I guarantee if you won the lottery this next week, you would tell somebody. Yeah. Well, maybe some of y'all wouldn't. I didn't win nothing. You know, don't worry, if you win the lottery, we'll know about it. You ever seen that movie with Richard Pryor in it where he, I think it's one of the Supermans, where he, those half cents and stuff, he goes, where are all those half cents on your checks? He goes, I don't know, they're just out there floating around. Well, he's a computer dude, and he figures out how to collect all those half cents. And it turns out to be a pretty big check. And the owner of the company realizes there's a bunch of money missing, and he says, how are we going to spot this? How are we going to find out who did this? He goes, don't worry, he'll show up. And next thing you know, he's driving in on Ferrari. And that's just like most of us. If we came into something, a lot of things would change, wouldn't it? Some of you go, no, I'll just carry on. Just same as always. Well, then just give it all to the church and carry on. Hallelujah. No, that's funny. How many of Jesus commanded us? It's not a request, it's a command. He commanded us to go out and tell everybody. Let's read it. In Matthew chapter 28, this is the Great Commission, not the Great Suggestion. It's the Great Commission. It says, verse 16, and when the 11 disciples left for Galilee, thought there was 12. Remember, one passed away. Hello? Just make sure you're paying attention. Going to the mountains where Jesus had told them to go, when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some of them doubted. Jesus said, Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority. This I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. I've been given all authority in heaven and in earth, on the earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them. How many are supposed to be? You're supposed to be a teacher. That's not my fivefold gifting. You're supposed to teach them something. Teach them what you know. You're only required to teach them what you know. I don't know that much. Well, then you can't really teach that much. But you should be able, if you've been forgiven, you should be able to convey that to somebody. You know, one reason I'm so happy is because I don't have any sin. Did you say never sin? I didn't say that. You're not listening. I said I don't have any. Because when I sin, I ask Jesus to forgive me, and he forgives me, so I'm not toting around this big backpack with sin. I used to. Before I met Jesus, man, this thing was loaded down. It was, how's it going? Having a good day. It was, guilt, shame, condemnation, all that stuff. I was toting it around just like some of y'all were. It was killing me. And the night I gave my heart to Jesus, he took that all away. I'm carefree, free of cares. Well, I gotta stress and worry about something. Well, if you want wrinkles and ulcers, carry on. But if you want to be happy and free, and the world look at you and go, man, what's different about you? We're supposed to be different. We're trying to blend into the world. The world's supposed to blend into us. Amen? Okay. Jesus said, all authority's been given to me. If he's got all the authority, that means Satan ain't got none. You know, Satan only can do, he operates in fear. When you activate fear in your life, Satan goes, oh, I got his attention. Fear does to the devil what faith does to God. So if you worry and get anxious and stuff like that, you're telling the devil whatever he's doing works. So don't get in fear. Because Jesus has all authority. Go therefore to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching these new disciples to obey all the commandments that I've given you. You know, you can't tell other people to obey something you don't. You know, if you obey the commandments, people should look at your life and see there's a change, there's something different about you. I want to tell you something. Being born again is a hoot. I am born again. I was born April 3rd, 1955, and June 15th, 1973, I was born again. What does that mean, born again? Well, when I asked Jesus to come to my heart, my spirit came alive, and I was born again. And all my sins were forgiven, all my past was forgiven. I had a peace and a joy come in my life that I never experienced before. I'm a different person and have been ever since. And I keep having these encounters with the Lord that just keep, it's not once, one encounter always. Man, I have these encounters all the time. I had one this morning. I was crying in the shower this morning. Yeah, I'm in the shower just, you know, washing my hair. That takes a long time. And I've got music playing. I'm listening to Shout to the Lord. And I'm listening to that song, and man, I am bawling. I'm moved by the Spirit of God. I just start breaking just love, the love of God. Just Jesus, God will touch you in the shower. Man, He'll touch you anywhere. Amen. Bible says all things are naked before the eyes of Him and the eyes of Him in whom we have to do. So He'll show up in the shower. Hello, and I'm just having a moment in the shower, bawling my eyes out, just feeling the love of God. Gosh, good thing you're in the shower. That way nobody could tell you was crying. You know, sometimes, one of these days in your life, you're going to have to choose dignity or deliverance. If you're always going to try to be this cool, dignified, suave, freaky guy, what's his name? What? You're always trying to be this guy that's so cool that he never shows emotion and he's just Mr. I've got it together. Then you're never really going to encounter the things of God. Because when you encounter the things of God, you're undone. Isaiah said, when I saw Him, I was like a dead man. You can't be cool in God's presence. You can't just sit there and, hey, how's it going, God? Hey, what's happening on the throne? Yeah. You see, you have an encounter with God, you're like butter in a microwave. And that's a good way to be. Because He's the God Almighty. The Bible says He flung the stars and they hang there. That's a pretty powerful God. Man, He's an amazing God. And you can know Him personally. Hallelujah. He's got an imagination, don't He? If you don't think He does, go to the zoo. Go to SeaWorld. Look at all those weird things. He's just got imagination. Some of y'all should let yours out of the box every once in a while. Some of y'all are so controlled, it's not funny. You've got your world so controlled that spontaneity, spontaneous. These are foreign words. I'm speaking in tongues to some of y'all going, spontaneous? What does that mean? Everything in my life is structured and organized. Ducks in a row, dominoes. That rhymes. That's pretty good. And I'm just winging it today. When you get all those dominoes set up, you know what Jesus loves to do? He loves to come by going, hey, look over there. And just walk away. What happened? He did it right there. See, I'm showing you. He does that. He loves to. When you try to get it all together, he goes, really? You got it all together? Yeah. Well, he just goes, well, what happens when you do this? Whoa. He loves it just to kind of mess with you. Because he wants you to trust him, not your abilities. Whose abilities? Trust his, not yours. All right, it's this Great Commission. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commandments I have given you. And be sure of this, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. He's with you how often? So when you're worrying and freaking out and fretting, you don't realize he's with you. Well, you know, spiritually, but not really. See, that's the problem with some folks. The real you is the spirit you. When you're born again, that's when life really starts happening. Your spirit, soul, and body. Your soul is the most deceptive thing in your life. You can't trust your emotions. Feelings. Nothing more than feelings. Feelings like I never had before. You can't trust your feelings. How many of you have ever been feeling really good and then somebody walked in the house? Who has the most power to upset you in a marriage relationship? That's right, your wife or husband. Just pay attention. Don't they? The people you love the most. If you're a child, who can upset you the most? Your mom and dad. Okay? Because their approval or disapproval of you really affects you. Miguel, if you're out there mowing the grass, you got everything looking so good, and then your dad comes in and goes, hey, Dad, I got the yard mowed. And he looks out there and goes, yeah, you left the rake out there. I mean, when we do that, I'm not that you do that. When we do that, don't think that doesn't. Word of knowledge. When we do stuff like that, don't our kids go, man, I spent an hour mowing this yard, got everything. I would get the ring, the rake, but we just point out the one thing that's not there. Hey, yeah, but you left the rake out there. Get the rake, son. Hello? What does that do to that young man? Golly, he doesn't, that's the only thing he can notice is the rake? You know, wife spends a wonderful afternoon working on this amazing dinner, and then and got a little busy, and the rolls got just a little dark on the bottom, not burnt, but just a little crisp. And he goes, this looks really good. What happened to the rolls? Really? That's the only thing you noticed was the rolls? What about this casserole? You know, what about, isn't that human beings? And what happens to your emotions? They can either go, woohoo, or they can go, woohoo. Don't want to live in the emotional realm. Listen, I live in an emotional realm, but I want, when my emotions don't go the way I want them to, I have the ability to turn them around by the Spirit of God. You can't do it any other way. Think positive. No, that don't work. Count to 10. 1, 2, 3. Oh, I hit something. Now, they have all these ways to control your soul, but really, God created you to have your soul controlled by your spirit because it needs authority. You ever heard kids, young people, you ain't the boss. See, we want to get 18. Magic number. We turn 18, what happens? You ain't the boss of me. I am now 18. I'm an adult. Not even close. But we think that, right? We want to get older so we can be the boss of us. I want to tell you something. I'm 62 years old, and I'm not the boss of me. I've learned to give it to him whose right it is. Well, there's a banner that says that here in church. Give it to him whose right it is. I let Jesus be the boss of me. Now, when I'm the boss of me, my wife can tell you, oh, yeah. Oh, he was really bossy yesterday. Amen. I'm actually not a bossy person, she'll tell you that. Don't complain about food. You know, my thing about food is I like it. Isn't that kind of obvious? Me and food have this relationship. I see it, I eat it. That's the seafood diet I'm on right now. I love it. But when I let Jesus govern my life, yeah, but I'm afraid if I give that control over to God, then he'll make my life boring. Let me tell you something. My life was boring before I met Jesus, and so was yours. And some of y'all right to this morning, your life's boring because you're not letting, either you're not born again or you're not letting Jesus have control of your life. Now, before I became a Christian, I had my dominoes all. When school was out on Friday, I got with my friends. We went someplace. We got high. We sat around and listened to Pink Floyd, eating donuts and stuff and laughing and giggling, acting like idiots. I was a professional idiot. I was so good at being stupid. Okay? And I did that weekend after weekend, year after year. I want to tell you something. That's boring. When I was 18, I became a Christian. Why? I was bored with this whole drug thing. I don't know how people stay on that merry-go-round for 30, 40 years. It's boring. You're not doing anything. You're not going anywhere. You're paranoid. That's another fancy word for fear. You're not making new friends. You're stuck with this handful of people, and you find out later they're not even all that cool. When I became a Christian, they all ditched me. Why? Because I wouldn't smoke pot with them? Oh, my goodness. Is that what our friendship is really comes down to? Your pastor smoked pot. That's past tense, people. Hallelujah. When I became a Christian, my life got exciting. Because I started telling folks about Jesus. And I didn't plan to get in the ministry. I just started telling people about Jesus. And these guys go, man, that's cool. I didn't know he was that way. He's like that? Oh, yeah, it's awesome. And all these kids started getting saved and coming out to my house. You were getting in the ministry? Unbeknownst to me. I didn't plan on getting in the ministry. I was just telling people about what God was doing. See, people are looking for God. They're not looking for religion. People are looking for God. They're looking for love. They're not looking for a bunch of rules and regulations and people to judge, be critical, and all that kind of stuff. That we got that in the world. But I just started loving people and caring about people and talking to folks and stuff, and I was really free. See, I thought I was free. I used to have hair down to here, and that, of course, that made you free. Now, we know that Kit is really free in our church. He's not here today, but he's the longest hair guy in the church. He's you know, so we know he's the coolest and the freest guy in the church. That was the way I thought in the 70s. I'm glad to report to you today. I don't think like that anymore. Because obviously the length of your hair has nothing to do with how cool you are. Now, what's your name again? Chauncey? He's got some pretty cool hair. Yeah. You were sporting the old Mohican there for a while. Now you got the scarf. I don't know where you are right now. It's just like, I think you're French. Parlez-vous français? I'm Jared. How are you doing? I'm the drummer at Church in Ramona. So, poor Jared. Yeah. A couple of Christmases ago, he showed up in that sweater vest thing. It's like, who is this guy? We love Jared. But see, I want to tell you something. Being free is not about rules and regulations. Some people work so hard to be free, that tells me right there they're not free. Some of y'all in this room are so, when I get around, you act so right. That tells me you're wrong. Because if you're really right, you don't have to act anyway. Well, that's Brother Mike. Hey, brother. I prayed all week and reading my Bible. Oh, my goodness. Me and the Lord. Whew, I'm telling you, it's just, see, that's not normal. Like some guy working on his car. You know, we used to do a skit about these two guys working on a car, and a sinner walks up, and then we just start talking religious. Hey, hand me a screwdriver. Hey, how's it going, Harold? Hey, you know the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory. And we just get, that's weird. We're trying to witness to him by quoting scripture, and he knows he's being aimed at. You know, if everybody shot you with paintballs, would you hang out with those people? I mean, if you just walked around, yeah, you're walking out your house, pat, pat, pat. Oh, man. But see, people call that witnessing. Pat, pat, pat. All of sin comes short of the glory of God. Thank you. Yeah, I feel good. Witnessing is not about quoting scripture to people, making people feel bad. Witnessing is having a life that people look at and go, gosh, man, I love how you treat people. I love how you encourage people. I love being around you, man, because you just have so much peace. You like being around Miss Beth. She's with joy, isn't she? Yeah. Not that you're lost. I know you're good, okay? That's right. I thought I was saved. But just, you want to be around people. See, I'm drawn to people that emanate Christ. People that don't, not as much fun to be around. I found some sinners are more fun to be around than some Christians. Some sinners are, most sinners aren't that critical and judgmental. Because most sinners know they're lost. They really don't have any room to throw stones. So a lot of them don't. Boy, howdy, sometimes Christians do. We're professional. Man, we can throw a curve. You won't even know where it's coming from. We can get you with ways that you have no idea. You're really good when you can do it and they don't know where it came from. All of a sudden they just feel bad. Jesus didn't come to make us feel bad. He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. All right. So we have this great commission to go out and make disciples, teach people. So my question is, you that have known Jesus for at least a year, okay, who are you working on right now? Who are you discipling? Who are you talking to? Who are you building a bridge to that doesn't know the Lord so you can reach out to them? See, I believe you have to build bridges to people. I don't believe you walk around and hand that little piece of the paper to people. Hey, read this. You know? Elton John sang a song about people passing out tickets for gold. He was talking about people witnessing. See, the world watches some of the stuff we do, and they write songs about it. And they even know it's not right. We should pay attention. But witnessing, True witnessing is building a bridge to somebody because you actually care about that person. You care about their life. You care about their family, whatever, and you want to help them. And you build this bridge over which truth can travel. See, people won't speak truth to you until they trust you. Nobody's going to bare their soul to you, even though you can see sometimes things in people's life that you can tell are wrong. But that's sometimes just the outside. Why do they do that? Why is that man that way? Why is that father so strict? Why is that mother not nurturing? Why are they? Are they not born that way? What happened? So you got to build that bridge to find out where they got hurt so you can get them unstuck. If you haven't seen The Shack, shame on you. Go see it. I talked with a preacher friend of mine the other day. I said, you seen it? I don't know. I've heard a lot of things. I said, well, go see it and figure it out yourself. I've read different reviews. Go see it. It's not a documentary, folks. It's not some kind of theological, dissertation of the New Testament. It's a fictional story, but it has a lot of truth in it. I didn't go to see Lord of the Rings and come out trying to find, the depths of salvation in it. It's amazing. We go watch a movie like that. We're not judgmental. Somebody makes a movie about God. Boy, we're critical to the nth degree. What is wrong with us? I said us, because this is a message to us. We're talking to the church today. Hallelujah. We're about to see some real funky people come in this building. Some real weird-looking folks. Man, one time I was at the store and looked at this guy, and he had so many piercings, I was thinking pincushion. And the Lord spoke to me and said, what are you doing? Well, I'm judging him, of course. When the Lord asks you, you have to come up with a spiritual answer. I'm just kind of meditating. Say something. Don't try and lie to the Lord. It's like playing hide and go seek with God. All right, you're over there. How do you see that? I can see through walls. I knew you was going to go there before you went there. I mean, God knows everything. But the Lord, he spoke to me. He said, why are you? He said, they're no different than you. Why did I grow my hair out back in the 70s when nobody else was? Just a handful of weirdos, okay? Well, I'm not weirdos. They were actually cool people. Now, the other guys were in bondage to the man. Nobody tells me to cut my hair. I'm free. Really? There's a domino going on here. Our freedom isn't based on this, right? So, the Lord said, why'd you grow your hair out? I said, to be cool. He said, no. See, he already knows the true answer. To be free. Because see, back then, nobody made you cut your hair, you were really free. That was the logic behind all that. And he said, these people just want to be noticed. Whether they got tattoos from head to toe, or they got piercings from head to toe, or they've got earlobes hanging down on their shoulder, whatever the thing is, they just want to be noticed. We got to love people in spite of what you see. Amen? We got people coming here going to be real confused about a lot of things. You still just got to love them. I mean, God is not the author of confusion. I'm asking Jesus to help me, Miss Cindy. I know what I'm a male. I know I am. See that? Oh, well, that's what you choose to believe. No, that's what God said I am. How many of us, that right now there's people that you get a choice in that matter? And I wasn't like that. I want to tell you something. The Bible says before Jesus comes back, they're going to say this. Everything's remained the same. Nothing's changed since our fathers fell asleep. I want to tell you something. Male and female, that's the only two genders on the planet. Been that way for about 6,000 years. Since God created Adam and Eve, which was about 6,000 years ago, folks. Well, when God said he made man, male and female. Okay, there's only been two. Just in the last few years, there's about six or seven now. Now, that isn't new. That's a new thing, isn't it? Bible says in the last days, they're going to say nothing's changed. Do you all not realize a bunch of stuff's changing? A guy in Texas just won the state championship for wrestling. because he wrestled on the girls' wrestling team because he identified as a girl, not a guy. You know, guys are stronger than most girls. Now, there's a few exceptions. But as a whole, most guys are stronger than women. Do you think it's fair a guy can wrestle with girls? Well, a lot of parents didn't like that ruling because this guy standing up with his trophies. But, you know, Al, standing up there as Alice, yeah! And the other girls are going, no! See, but you know, we just got to accept that because that's what he chose. He's a guy. He's a guy that thinks he's a girl. Now, some of you are going, Brother Mike, you need to get more progressive. You're just not moving forward. Pray for me that I will stay the same. The Bible says they're ever learning, never coming to the knowledge of the truth. I want to tell you something. The truth don't change. That's what I love about God. Truth don't change. Something that's true is true. You know, gravity's true. All right. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus said, you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. We're going to be his what? His witnesses. A witness is somebody that's experienced or seen something. How many of y'all have experienced or seen the love of God? Anybody ever showed you some ridiculous kindness that was beyond? I know people in this room that have been given houses and cars. Just people, not even from family members. I mean people saying, I just really appreciate you. Here's a house. I mean, that's kind of cool. So with the Great Commission, go out and tell somebody. Well, that's not my ministry. Well, I'm just telling you it is. He told everybody to do this. Pastor, that's what we pay you to do. Now, number one, you don't pay me to do your job. My job is to train you, to teach you how to get out and do this so you can go out and do it. And that's really what the Scripture says. He gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers for the maturing of the saints. See, my job is to mature you, so it says, for the work of the ministry, so you can go out and do the work of the ministry. Amen? In the workplace where people are around you, they see you and stuff, they should say, man, what's, you know, Scott, you're different. Well, thank you. They should say that. Not like, man, you blend in, Scott. You're just one of the bros. Somebody said you go to church. Come on. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Having fun. All right, let's look at Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. Verse 9. This is Jesus calling Matthew to be a disciple. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at his tax collector's booth. Follow me and be my disciple, Jesus said to him. So Matthew got up and followed him. Later, Matthew invited Jesus to his disciples to his home to have dinner as a guest. Along with many tax collectors and other disreputable sinners. I mean, when you first met Jesus, you were hanging out with sinners. So if you met me and I led you to the Lord, you invited me over for dinner and you brought your friends, how many of your friends would probably be sinners? Yeah, that's what's going on here. But when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with such scum? This is what the New Living Translation says. Why does he eat with those deplorables? Oh, my goodness. When Jesus heard this, he said, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. Then he added, now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. I want you to show mercy, not offer sacrifice. For I have come to call not those who think they're right, but those who know they're sinners. I want to tell you something. That's how I live. You'll never find me really arguing and debating with somebody and trying, you know, raising my voice and, you know, trying to prove something to somebody. Because if somebody wants to believe a lie, I let them. But I run into people all the time that are going, I haven't got a clue. Man, I'm looking for people that are done. People that are that are tired of trying to fake it. You know when you're done because you're really, you know, how many of y'all been playing cards with the devil? Ooh, I got two jacks. That looks promising. You're never going to have a hand to beat them. I'm a sucker for when we play card game stuff. I get some color in my hand. Oh, yeah. And then my wife, what do we play? Rummy. And then she's like, I'm out. Oh, man. I got like 1,000 points in my hand. But I'm a sucker for those aces and those, you know, because I think something good's coming out of that. But I get, you know, don't always win. But see, when you're playing with, if the devil's your dealer, you're never going to win because he don't play right. You got to get to the end of when you fold, you go, I'm done. I want a new dealer. See, I wanted Jesus to start. When Jesus deals you a hand, it'll work. Amen? I'm looking for people that are done. Hallelujah. Those who know they're sinners. People that know they're lost. People that know, I don't have any joy. My peace is temporary. It's depending on what's going on in my life. And that's subject to change all the time. What makes people look at us and go, y'all are different? Because we can have joy in the midst of stuff going wrong in our life. I can't tell you how many times my wife will say, don't use the card, hon. We got like $2 in the bank. Okay. And that don't bother me. Some of y'all would be, $2. Oh, my gosh. I would just be freaking out if there were $2 in my account. I don't know how this man lives like this. Because it just means I can't go get something from the store. No big deal. I don't need it. I don't have to go through McDonald's and get an ice cream cone to make my day. It helps, but I don't have to. When I'm really feeling splurgy, dip it in chocolate. Come on. Whether, if I can go to the 99 cent store and get me a couple bags of seeds, woohoo! If it don't happen, no big deal. My joy is not based on stuff. Man, I got deposit. Real freedom and peace is in here. Hallelujah. So in Matthew chapter 9, why does your teacher eat with such scum? Here's the thing I want us to see today. Do y'all realize we used to be that scum he's talking about? We forget that as Christians. I've been saved almost 45 years. That's a long time to be walking with Jesus. You forget that you were a booger. I was a serious booger. In fact, there's a scripture talks about this. Speaking of boogers, hey, Steve. Ephesians. All the way from Palmdale. Desert. Isn't that amazing somebody drives that far to come to church here? That humbles me. Some of y'all, I just came around the corner and I was late. Yeah. Yeah, think about that. Oh, thank you, Jesus. All right, let's look at this scripture in Ephesians chapter 2. Look at verse 1. Once you were dead. So it says, once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. You know, sin, the wages of sin is what? What does sin earn you? Death. It kills your relationship with God. Okay? It says, and once you were dead. Do you realize we all were dead? That's why you had to get born again. What do you mean about dead? I can breathe. Life isn't about breathing and eating food and all that kind of stuff. Life is about, true life's about tapping into the life that God wants you to have. And if you're living this mundane, carnal, eat food, process food, sleep, wake up, go to amusement park, have fun, work, sweat, da, da, da. If you're living that world, that's temporary because that's in this life, if that's all you come into, that's going to pass away one day. There's an eternal life you can tap into. And eternal life doesn't start when you die. I have eternal life right now. I'm living a life through the Spirit. And the word life, there's two Greek words for the word life in the Bible. One is Zoe, means God life or eternal life. How many of y'all want to live a God life? A life that God lives. You ever think God gets depressed? No. no depression. You ever think God worries? Doesn't worry. Doesn't have stress. Doesn't bite his fingernails. Doesn't sit there. We think, Jesus, I don't know, this is a tough one. We didn't think this one through, did we? Nah, it's never a problem with God. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and end. You know, God's already seen this. He knows how the outcome. What do you think is going on in the world? What's the stuff with Russia? What's this Putin guy doing? Man, I think we're in trouble. God's got, he's got it all together. He knows what's going to happen. He's already seen the end of the story. What about Israel? God's got it. What if China comes down in Russia? God's got it. What about the Antichrist? God's got it. What about the Mark of the Beast? God's got it. Let's just put up a bunch of food. Let's go buy some land and just, you know, I went, been there, done that. In the early days of my Christianity, I had these meetings called farm meetings. And a bunch of young people were getting together from, because we thought like the farm, we'll just get away from the world and just live out and buy some land and build log cabins and the girls can make quilts and we'll just grow our own food and we'll just get away from temptation. Then we won't have to deal with this stuff. Well, see, Jesus didn't call you to be a light to the corn crop, the cornfield. He called you to be a light to the world. He didn't save you to stick you over under a bushel somewhere and go, yeah, hide out here until I come back. That'll inspire people. He said, get on a candlestick. Let everybody see. You are a city set on a hill. Hide downtown San Diego. Well, you can't hide it. It's huge. See, God's supposed to be so huge in your life that you can't even when you get around sinners, you can't, you know, when you try to act like them, it doesn't come out real good. You know? You know, you can't even talk like them anymore. Amen? Well, you're not supposed to. Hallelujah. So, once you were dead because of your disobedience and many sins, you used to live in sin. Notice it says used to. I don't live in sin every day. Do you? Oh, you got to sin every day. It's in the Bible. Where? I've been looking for it. Ain't found it. Second Hesitations 3:1. Thou shalt sin every day. Check that off the list. Move on. No, you don't have to sin every day. Some people go, I think most of us do, probably, but you don't have to. All right. You used to live in sin just like the rest, what? Just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil. You know, don't you like being free? When you know the devil, you're like a puppet on a string. He says, do this. You go, okay. You got no control because you're under his dominion. Jesus cuts the string like Pinocchio. I'm a real boy. That's right. Hallelujah. Obeying the devil, the commander and the of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us, hear the word all? All of us used to live that way. Everybody in this room. Well, I was never really, you know, I never did drugs like you, brother. Like you were like a really bad sinner. I was just kind of a minor sinner. That's like saying dead. You were really dead. I was just kind of sort of dead. This isn't Princess Bride. Mostly dead. We, you know, dead is dead, folks. Amen? No, you were like that roadkill that's been run over so much, it's like hairy paper. You know, just, we can't even tell what it is. It's just, what was that? Who knows? I don't know. It's been run over so many times. See, that's, some of y'all, I was just like, just freshly hit, boom, and I was just kind of still twitching. Really? Whatever works for you, helps you sleep at night. Let's just read what it says. We were dead. We're dead. I don't care if you can cuss the wallpaper off a wall. You never said a cuss word. You were still dead. I don't care if you never drug and drank every drink and did everything wrong or, you know, just was a good old boy. If you don't know Jesus, you're dead. All right, so it says, he is the spirit that works in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. Did y'all follow your own thing? It's y'all thing. Do what you want to do. Didn't y'all live that way? Just Ryan's mom. Some of y'all, I heard somebody went, it's my prerogative. Well, whatever your prerogative was, you did it. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger. How many of y'all knew you had a payday coming, but you just didn't care? I knew when I was lying to my parents. I knew when I was doing stuff wrong. I just, at that time, just didn't care. Just like everyone else. What? Everyone else. Notice these words? All, everybody, everyone. See, we're all the same. God created us to have a relationship with Him. We need to know God. Until you find God, until you really come into a relationship with Him, you're just kind of just flailing around. Kind of, oh, whatever's going on. Next. Falling in one ditch, out crawling out. Boy, that was a bummer. Whoa! Into another ditch, get out of that. Man, that sucks. Whoa! You know, we're walking in the dark. Somebody cut the light on. Jesus is that light. And when He cuts the light on, you know what's so cool about getting the light cut on? Then you can see all this darkness you were in going, oh my gosh, yikes. When you're in it, it doesn't seem that bad. When you cut the light on, you go, whoa, I really feel bad that I did that to that person. I really feel bad that I said that to that person. I really feel, see, when you're in the dark, you don't see all that. Amen? But when Jesus cuts the light on, it's not to make you go, boy, that was gross. Amen? But, you know, part of what they, true repentance is acknowledging that you were gross. I was gross. You know what Paul says? He says, I was chief of sinners. You got to acknowledge that what you're doing was wrong. And not, it's not my fault, the lights were off. Well, you know, at some point you have to say, I'm just so thankful. It was my fault, but I was in darkness. But thank you, Jesus, the light's on, and I don't want to do this anymore. And you know, what I love about Jesus, the Bible says we've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His dear Son. Translated. I mean, God literally moves you, puts you in a different. Yesterday, my little buddy here, well, not little, but Dave T. Troyer went to Disneyland. How old are you? 52? 52-year-old man, first time in his life ever went to Disneyland. I said, it's kind of a magical place. He goes, man, it's awesome. I want to go back there again. 52 years, never been to Disneyland. That is wrong. Well, he was in a religion years ago that said, if you're having fun, you're probably sinning, so you can't, in that religion, you couldn't do anything. So in that religion, they would never allow him to go to Disneyland. You know what? Disneyland out front says happiest place on earth. It can't. I mean, how much sin are you going to get involved? If you can sin at Disneyland, you're bad. You are bad. Not a lot of sinning going on at Disneyland. I punched Pluto. I'm sorry. I mean, it's my goodness. But he experienced something he never experienced. I want to tell you something. Satan will keep your world so small you won't experience life. And see, he was in a religious system trying to get close to God by not doing what the world does. But see, he was missing out on a lot of cool things, wasn't he? He watched The Wizard of Oz in my house one time. He had never seen that show. Here's another one. You want somebody fun to hang out with, take this guy bowling or do something with him. He said, anything, you can go skating or do something, paintballing. He's probably never, there's a lot of first-timers here. No. I remember one time we were bowling, and he's like, how is this sin? This is awesome. Because all your life you're told, if you're having fun, you're sinning. And that's that. But these are people that are thinking they're making God happy by making their lives miserable. See, I want to tell you something. Only Jesus can make you free. Religion won't make you free. Brother Mike, you don't seem that religious. Well, thank you. God bless you. I'm not religious. I was sitting at a restaurant yesterday, and these two ladies were talking about going to something, and there was a group of young people, and they sang Amazing Grace at this thing. And this one lady says to the other, I was a little uncomfortable. I didn't think it was appropriate. Kind of felt a little, because the lady next to me was from Turkey. And I was just wondering, how is she feeling about that? We are so apologetic. This is America, folks. We believe in God in America. It says it on our money. In God we trust. God shed His grace on thee. It's in our songs. When they swear in the presence, He puts His hand on the Bible. not a dictionary. But we're so, and the sad thing was, this was an old lady, older than me.
So you're going, oh man, ancient of days.
See, the thing is, when the Bible says when the ears should speak, this person was embarrassed that somebody was talking about Jesus in a public setting in America. I want to tell you something. I found myself, my wife tells you, I'm sitting back going, you know, Jesus is Lord, honey.
Shh, honey, honey.
Yep. Every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God. I love Jesus, honey. Don't you love Jesus? She's like, honey, honey, honey. Yeah, let's don't offend her. See, be careful about this being politically correct. That you don't offend anybody. Man, I'll tell you what, Jesus Christ, one of the most offensive guys I know. I love him. He didn't walk around going, hey, I hope this don't bother you. Man, he talked about God. He talked about God. He in this chapter 9, he heals this guy. And somebody goes, the Pharisee said, hey, he says, your sins are forgiven you. Get up and walk. And they go, hey, you can't forgive sin. He says, what's easier, to say your sins are forgiven or take up your bed and walk? He says, the Son of Man has power to forgive sin. Blasphemy! Man, I'm going to tell you something. Pharisees are always finding fault. If you find fault, that's the first thing that comes up when you see a situation is you judge it, good or bad, right or wrong, whatever. You might want to pray about that. That's a wrong attitude to have. Because you're putting yourself over everybody else. If you want to be the judge, the Bible says if you humble yourself, God will exalt you. But it says if you exalt yourself, God will humble you. See, God's job is to exalt you if he thinks it's the right time and you're okay. But if you do God's job and exalt yourself, then he'll have to do your job and humble you. You want to be careful about judging everything. Hallelujah. I'm going to finish here. So let's start finding some scum to hang out with. That's what I'm trying to talk about. We get right back in this scripture. Don't y'all have some scummy neighbors and friends? Don't y'all have some deplorable people that you can go say, hey, you are just not right. I've been watching your life for weeks. Your dog poops in my yard. You never come clean it up. I've confronted you about it. You deny it. I've got you on video. But, you know, I want to work with you. I think it's time I'm going to build a bridge to you. I would not approach it that way. But I'm going to tell you something. Next Sunday is Easter. You need to invite people to church. I mean, I want to, but I'm like, I really do, but I never know what you're going to say. I feel like some Sundays, man, I wish my friend was here and they could have heard that. They would have really dug that. And then other weeks you say things like you just did about scum, and I go, oh, that's not. Are you going to talk about, a religion or something? They're, oh, my friend's Catholic, and you're going to say something about the Pope, and it's like, oh. Dominoes. Hallelujah. Have y'all not figured out I'm not politically correct? Yeah, I don't want to be politically correct. Well, if you were right, you would. No, when you're free, you're not. There's a difference from being politically correct and offensive. I don't want to be offensive to people, but I'm not going to lie to people and tell people they're okay when they're not. Amen? Part of being a parent is not that you're your buddy. My wife is about to do a teaching on training children. We got a lot of little kids in the house here, and from what I can tell, some of them need some help. Okay? I'm not saying your child's, a hellion or nothing. But we're going to do some teaching on it. And it's going to be good. Because some of y'all negotiate with your children. That's not, you train your children. The Bible says train up a child in the way that he should go, and he gets older, he won't depart from. That word train in the Hebrew means narrow their choices. It's the opposite of what some of y'all are doing. Now, if you quit throwing a fit here at the supermarket, I'll give you a candy bar. You're rewarding bad behavior, but you're embarrassing me, so here's a candy bar. Stop it. You narrow their choices. Because we're training and teaching our children about authority and how to relate to authority. Because one day they're going to be out from under our authority They're going to be transferred over to God's authority. And if you don't do it right, you're going to screw them up. Because God, when he says no, he means no. Thou shalt not. See, if you negotiate with your kids, they're going to think, well, yes, my dad said no, but that meant just keep crying and you get your way. Just keep lying and it works out. So you can't, you're training your children to fail. You got to, you're supposed to be representing God to your children. God's authority, God's ways. Hello? Otherwise, when they get older, they're going to think, God's like mom and dad. You just keep pushing it. Push your agenda. He'll come around. I know he says, thou shalt not, but it's me. You know, as cute as you are, God's still not moved by it. He made you that way. So, but he, you know, when he says, God is not mocked, whatever a man sows, that shall also reap, he means that. Well, he doesn't mean that to everybody. No, he means that. So we got to teach our children the right way. I want to tell you, number one, you'll have more peace in your house. They'll have more peace. Because the lions have fallen in pleasant places. The boundaries of the Lord are for our protection. They're not. God doesn't put boundaries in our life to make our life miserable. He puts boundaries in our life to make our life good. How many of y'all like the boundaries in your life? I don't want any more freedom than the Word of God gives me. It's plenty. Any more than that will be destructive. I know me. The Bible says to make no provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust. Thereof. Where is it? Thereof. That means it's there. Hello? I don't sit down at that pie in front of me. I cut a piece and put it back in the fridge. Why? Because if you put it in front of you, you're going to eat a little more. Bren's not home. This is her piece. I'll help her out. You know, we just do things. You know, don't make provisions. Because you'll fulfill. Don't make no provisions for it. Hallelujah. All right. Let me finish this scripture. All of us used to live this way, following the passion, desires of our inclinations, our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead, roadkill, unrecognizable, because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Jesus from the dead. I don't know about you. We're celebrating next Sunday about the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. There's a movie out right now. It's called A Case for Christ. It's a story of Lee Strobel. He used to be an atheist and was a full-blown, hardcore atheist. And he set out to disprove the Bible and in the process became a Christian. It's hard to make a lie out of something that's the truth. There's a guy up in Julian. He wrote a couple books. His name's Josh McDowell. He, in college, made a bet with some of the other college buddies that the Bible was full of contradictions and lies, and he made a bet that he could disprove it. Well, when you try to prove the truth to be a lie, you're in for a real journey. Well, he got saved. He wrote a book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Then he wrote another one called More Evidence That Demands a Verdict. You know, God has all kinds of people. I'm not one of them. God has intellectual people because some people are intellectual. I'm not one of them. I thank God for a believing heart. God said it. That's it. I believe it. Some people, well, it says that, but I don't know. But some people go at it with their minds, and that's not a bad thing, and that's not a right or wrong thing. That's just how you know, some people go that way. But see, God's got people that know you think that way, and he's got people that scrutinize it, put it under a microscope, chop it up, dissect it, do it all stuff, and prove it. You know, Kevin's got a teaching mantle on him. He doesn't just read the Bible, okay. He goes, well, why does it say that? Why does it mean that? What? And back in those days, what did it mean when they said that? I mean, that's how he reads. I don't read that way. I just, Jesus loves me, this I know. I mean, it's just pretty simple. The intellectuals are being offended. All right. He gave us life when he raised Jesus from the dead. Next Sunday, invite your neighbors. Invite a friend. You know, what if you brought a friend to church and they gave their heart to the Lord? You know what? You're going to have a buddy for life. I remember one time this guy came to our church. Y'all know him. His name's Al McCormick. He came to watch his daughter be in a play. He thought, play? That's safe. Did this play. It was so, he got so convicted. I remember stepping up, giving an altar call. This is like 20 years ago. And gave an altar call. And, man, his hand didn't go up just like kind of, you know. He was like, he looked like, go boom! He's just like some kind of Nazi guy. But he raised his hand. He gave his heart to Jesus. And from that day to this day, we've been friends. Y'all got saved on an Easter morning. And your life's been pretty good since then, huh? Oh, yeah. So I'm going to tell you something. You got neighbors and friends that are looking for the truth. Now, you don't have to stand out in their yard with a radio and like a skit. What movie's that from? Say Anything. I knew it. You know, you don't have to do it. There's other ways of doing it. But invite them. You know, a lot of people have had bad experience at church. It's sad, but that's true. Some people have been there and been judged, been criticized, made fun of, and had bad experiences. Some people went to church where it's supposed to be safe and had boundaries crossed and felt very unsafe. So this is a place where you're supposed to feel safe and feel love and make friends. I don't know if I want to get friends with this. Yeah. Comes with friends. It's not just one entree. It comes with friends and soup and salad. It's wonderful. Friends that will love you, care about you when you get sick, when they'll come visit you. When you have babies, they bring you food and watch your kids and stuff. It's wonderful. We actually care about each other. We don't just come here, you know. My friends are the people I worship with. Hallelujah. One more scripture. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 2, it says, I know the things that you do. I have seen your hard work. Now, he's talking to the church. These are Christians. I've seen the hard work that you do, your patience, endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they're apostles but are not. You have discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. Oh, that's pretty good stuff. But he says, verse 4, but I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at the first. The King James says you've lost your first love. In the Greek, that actually reads, you've lost your bridal love. Now, I was with Bryn up in Mammoth here a couple months ago. One of the things when I was up there, I realized I don't do this enough. Maybe sometimes you got to get your wife on a cruise or something, and you realize we should really do this more often. Because when you're with your wife, okay, just if you're not married, great, no, just pour the salt on the moon, brother. I'm single, okay. Use your imagination and try to see if you can see how this relates. But when I'm with her and it's just us and there's no grandkids and there's nobody else, there's no ministry stuff going on, it's just me and her, we actually have a lot of fun. We had a blast yesterday. And sometimes I realize I need to spend more time just with her and nobody else because it does something. It stirs up something. A few months back, last fall or something, we got to stay at a condo down in Mission Bay for a couple of days. And we're just walking down the boardwalk. We're not you know, scuba diving or whatever. We're just hanging out for a few days. And it hit me again. You really should do this more often. And I've done it like three times since then. But so you're going, well, that's better. I haven't done it yet. Well, but this is not about who did what. Get the point. When you spend time together, it rekindles that first love. It makes you remember, this is one of the reasons I married you, because you're a lot of fun to be with. I like that you laugh at my jokes. We're getting to that weird, creepy, been together for a long time because we're finishing each other's sentences and saying the same thing out loud. It's getting really creepy these days. But we're laughing a lot. When you get old, the longer you get married, it's not supposed to go, yeah, and it just keeps getting weirder and weirder and more bondage, more and more. You know, a lot of comedians make fun about marriage and stuff, and it's easy to do that. But, you know, Jesus didn't. He said you lost your first love, your bridal love. He says, what he tells us to do, he says, go back and do the first works. You don't love me. I'm going to tell you something. If you don't love Jesus right, you ain't going to be able to love nobody else right. And I said ain't, so deal with it. Ain't's not a word. It ain't in the dictionary. Well, it is in the dictionary, so get over it. I have one complaint against you. You don't love me or each other. The Bible says you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. If you don't love God, you can't do the second one. You won't never be able to love your neighbor as yourself if you don't love God right. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the first works that you did. When you first got married, what did you do? Nobody had to tell you to hang out together. You just wanted to. You couldn't wait to get off work and get home and be with her. When we were dating, I couldn't wait to call her. I called her throughout the day. Hey, I was thinking about you. I'll call her today. I love you. Okay. I know it's only been an hour, but, you know, hey. I remember those days. That was forever. You know, I didn't know that much about her, and I loved her. I mean, I've learned more about her since then, and, you know, there's more to love. I mean, when you first fall in love with Jesus, you don't know nothing about him. You give your heart to him. He forgives all your sin. You're going, I feel real, real good, but you don't know anything, but you sure enough love him. Right? And when you start reading this book, you start finding out all the stuff he's done. You go, wow, that was for me. By his stripes, you were healed. I got healed of stomach ulcers one night when I was hanging out in the woods and I was reading my Bible. And I came across the scripture, by his stripes you were healed. Were? That's past tense. I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed, but I can understand that. And I went, I said, oh, well, Jesus, thank you for healing my ulcers. And I got my little VW bug at 2 in the morning, and I went down to Sambo's. That's the rest now was Denny's. And I ordered me a chili size. I'm going to prove, see if this thing works. Ate that sucker, and nothing happened. And a little voice said, you better get some milk. Neutralize that. You're going to be on fire. And a Coke. I hadn't had a Coke in a year. I went vegetarian, not because it's cool, because every time I ate meat, it hurt. I had ulcers. It's weird when you pull up to Burger King. I'd like a big chef, no meat. What? You get that a lot. What? No meat. You want lettuce, tomatoes, and pickles? Yeah, that's what I want. A salad sandwich. I'm sorry, it's hard to act cool about that one. That don't seem cool in anything. But I couldn't eat chocolate. Woo, I know, unpardonable sin. Because every time I'd eat it, my stomach would just hurt. Living on Maalox and Rolaids. But I read one night, Jesus said, by his stripes I've healed you. See, when they laid that whip to Jesus' back and ripped his flesh, it produced healing for mine. And I went that night and I ate that and nothing happened. I wanted to find out if this is true. I went to the doctor because I had x-rays that proved I had ulcers. I just had them done a few months before. He went back and made some more x-rays and said, I don't know what happened to you, Mike, but you got this picture. You got 3 ulcers the size of quarters, which at 19, he said, you have an old man's stomach. But here, look, these x-rays make your – it looks like you have a brand new stomach. And see, I'm going to tell you something. When I met Jesus, I take him at his word. If he says he can heal your body, he can heal your body. If he says he can deliver you from addiction, he can deliver you from addiction. If he says he can give you joy in the midst of a storm, I take him up on it. And I found out everything that he said he could do, he can do. And I'm telling you, I'm excited about loving and living for Jesus. You think you're going to get tired of this? You think you're going to retire soon? Man, I'm just giving him a stride. I'm just loving this thing. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, I want to tell you something. We need to get back. When you get back and do the first works. When I met Jesus, telling people about the Lord came natural. I told every one of my friends that I used to do drugs with, I told them, hey, I found what we're looking for. It wasn't pots, not acids, not mushrooms, and all the other stupid stuff we did. It's Jesus. Now, this is the Bible Belt. There's over 400 churches in our town of 50,000 people. We have about 40,000 people in Ramona, and we have 28 churches. 428. People, we have a lot of churches in Ramona. I'm thinking, this is virgin territory here. We don't have a lot of churches in Ramona. You know, if everybody in Ramona wanted to go to church today, we don't have room for them. There'd be people, the majority, 90% of the population would be standing outside going, they're all full. So it's not like we're doing a good job. We're not. We got to tell people. Easter's next Sunday. Tell your neighbors. Invite them. Are you proud about what God's doing in this building? Are you ashamed of me? Thank you, Scott, for that vote of confidence. He's going, no. Carly, you're not ashamed, are you? No. Y'all love Miss Brenda? She's a pretty good teacher, huh? Lucy, I know you like her better than me, but I forgave you. It's okay. Hey, word gets around. Man, Miss Brenda, she's really good. Brother Mike's good, but I think she's better. It's okay. Everything she knows, I taught her. Just comes right on back. If you guys have trouble with being insecure, hang out with me. You will be secure. Hang out a week with me. You'll be so secure, people won't even want to be around you. No, it's not true. Amen. I'm not ashamed of you, and I know you're not ashamed of me. But I want to tell you something. I love what God's doing in this place. I love the presence of God that's in this house. I love the acceptance. What's your name again? Ryan's mom? Elizabeth. You came last week. Do you feel loved and accepted? Yeah, she came back this week. Promotion side, folks. You know, we don't have trouble getting people from out of town. It's the locals we can't seem to get. We can't get the locals to come here. I don't know. What's wrong with us, Cindy? I don't know. But you know what? There's people, you're cutting their hair, Miss Rebel. You're cutting their hair. Sometimes they're sitting in their chair and you're having this conversation, and it's the same old conversation about life and sometimes how unhappy they are and what their husband's doing or not doing and stuff. And something inside you wants to rise up and say, you know, I know somebody can fix that. It's not me, folks. Jesus. You want to come to church with me? You want to come to church with me? Because some people just need to get in the presence of God. We sing about it all the time. In His presence, you satisfy my soul. In His presence. If you just get them in the house of God, they'll feel something they don't feel at Stater Brothers. They don't feel it out there in the world. They don't feel it at the movie theater. They don't feel it, you know, at restaurants. It's something different because His presence comes in this house. And when they feel that peace, when they feel that love and acceptance, they're going, man, this is a weird feeling. I feel like these people care. I don't even know them. And you find out, you come another week, you find out, well, I wonder if that was just a fluke. And you come back the next week and you go, wow, it's even worse this week. But worse in a good way. This is real. These people really do care about me. Yeah. Well, I'm telling you something. There's a lot of folks out there that want what you have, and they just don't know. You know, this is open to the public, but, you know, a lot of people don't feel that way. They feel like if they've been in churches where they sat down and people come up and go, excuse me, you're in my seat. I am making this up. There are people in the South that have pews, and some of them have paid for them. They got their name, the Hall Pew. They do this in the South. They have pew-raising things. They raise money, and there are people that sit in the same place. I can't wait for the people to come get in your seats. I can't wait for you to come there some Sunday, you know, a whole family sitting on your row. We're going to have to move. Huh? What's going on? But that's what we want. We want home invasion. This is not our home.
This is just where we meet in the center and worship God. I look for the day when you have to go sit in the balcony because you're going, wow, all the high dollar seats. Yeah, those are cheap seats. Actually, those are the people that are actually closer to God. They're like 12 feet closer than you and I. But when people get your seat, what do you mean my seat? Well, it's the one you sit in, you sit in every week. That's Mike and Simone's seat. I ain't seen nobody sit there in years. But, we don't have seats. We want people. We want, amen? And when you have people and they come in here and they encounter that presence and they meet the Prince of Peace, you're going to have a friend for life right there. They're going to thank you, man. I so appreciate you. You know, Bob Marcy is really glad that you guys showed him what this place is. I know Bob, I mean, not Bob Marcy, Rob and Marcy. I know he's on the road a lot, but, man, Rob's grateful. Marcy's grateful. Hallelujah. All right. So you're gonna bring somebody next week?
Oh, that's kind of pushing the envelope. Are you going to behave next week?
Can't make no promises. I'm gonna share whatever Jesus puts on my heart. Well, it's Easter. You're going to preach the Easter message. You know that I follow that. Not necessarily. If he has me share about Easter, I will. But, I was in my office. Matt came in there this morning. I'm sitting there still waiting on the Lord to give me something to talk about. Don't you know stuff? I know a lot of stuff. Well, not a lot, but I know some stuff. But the thing is, it's not about just having a message, coming up here with a message. It's having a message that feels like it speaks to you right today. I felt like, I just waited on the Lord. And it's like 30, it's 9:30. Been down here for hours and bing. All week, bing. About quarter till, he starts talking to me. Now, I've learned something about Jesus. I'm not moved by that because he likes us to work with him. I know a pastor one time that brags on the fact that he spends 40 hours a week working on his message. He reads so many books and over 40 to 60 hours a week on his sermon. He's so proud of his sermons, that's the problem. I asked him one time, I said, what happens when you got that message and you're walking up to the pulpit and the Lord says, I don't want you to talk about that. I want you to talk about something else. He goes, that never happens. And I'm thinking, it's sad because it happens to me all the time. People, it's not about just looking in this book and coming up with sermons. It's finding out what's in your heart, what God wants to do. And obviously God wants you to start telling people. Amen? You got friends. You got people that need to come here and experience the peace and love of God. Amen? So, let's do our job. I'll do my job to hear from him. You do your job to bring people in. We'll see what happens. Amen? All right. Today's the last day of this teaching that the ladies have been. How many ladies have enjoyed this teaching Brenda's been doing? It's okay, Lucy, you can say amen. I'm secure, girl. It's okay. I'm secure. It's been good, hasn't it? The broken way. Well, today's the last one, so if you guys have missed them, come check it out. I've noticed that I love the camaraderie when people get together. I like small groups. Amen? It's pretty cool how God knits you with people. So she's going to take a few weeks off, then she's going to be doing a teaching on raising children. They're not in here right now. They're all in the nursery. But there's some moms here that absolutely need some help because they're like, this is way so much work. But see, one thing I'll tell you about God, I have a friend that used to say, let's work smarter, not harder. I'm always for those guys. These are guys that rent equipment. I like people that rent equipment. I have a little riding tractor. I could mow the field that is next to the house, but it would take me several days and it'd probably tear up my mower. I want to rent a tractor. Let's mow that sucker and so we don't lose our kids. Right now, it's the jungle. Don't worry, that's not you. I'm not. That's you. Don't even have to even think about going there. Like I feel back pain coming with this blessing. But you want to work smarter, not harder. God's ways are always better. If you train up children and they work with you, life gets way more fun. You're not these parents going, I'll be glad when you're 18. Kids are going, I'll be glad I'm 18. Parents are going, not half as glad as I will be. That's not how God wanted us to raise children. Amen? He wants us to be, you know, Abraham and all his kids all lived together for a long time. The Bible says really the only reason you should move out is because you're getting married. For this cause, a man leaves his mother and father and cleaves to his wife. My kids have lived with me until they got married. I didn't have that law. You're 18. God bless. Yeah. Tomorrow Kevin turns 18. He's moving out. That's not how we live. I enjoy my children. They're a blessing. Amen? And your kids are supposed to be a blessing too. Mine's broke. Mine aren't a blessing. Train them to be a blessing. You train children to be a blessing. The Bible says a child left to himself is his mother's shame. You don't put boundaries and you don't deal with them, they will embarrass you, guaranteed. And they will make a lot of work. And it's they don't know any better because they've not been trained. You ever have a dog that's not trained? You ever have dogs, you know, sorry about that. I mean, my son got a dog recently, and it was so wild he had to take it back. He said, this is an unruly dog. It's biting people and stuff. I said, no, thank you. You want, amen? He compared children to dogs. Yeah, it's stuff like that. I can't bring my neighbors. He doesn't have a check valve. Pray for me. I'm telling you, you can bring people to this picnic and then want to become Christians. Seriously, because we have fun. How many of y'all used to hear the devil tell you, you know, if you become a Christian, you won't have that much fun? That's what I heard for years. I was planning on becoming a Christian. I had people witness to me when I was out there in the world. I said, no, not right now, not right now. I believe in God, just not right now. I'm having too much fun. I'm waiting till I'm like 30. Remember we thought that was old? Yeah, you know, I'm 30 and I can't have fun anymore because I'm like almost dying. Then I'll give my heart to the Lord and I'll have a wife and kids and you know we'll just get into that bored thing that most people do. But right now I'm having fun, so I don't want Jesus. That was a lie. I'm so glad I met Jesus at 18 where I got to really kick in and have some fun. I've been having fun ever since. I just keep having more fun. Right, y'all have fun? Yeah, sometimes go out and do a little putt-putt. And sometimes I do a little croquet at the house, a friend's house. We'll come next Sunday and we'll show you what fun looks like. We'll have a good time. Last year playing musical chairs for those plastic chairs. We're going to have waivers this year. Okay, sign this. You can't play this game until you sign this. That was fun. Every year we have casualties, two or three chairs a year. That's a good. That's how we measure parties. It was a four chair breaker. Good times. All right. Turn around and hug somebody and look at somebody and say, I'm so glad you came today. You needed this. And you're dismissed.